Okay, good afternoon. You probably saw the message that Netta is not feeling well today, so we will have 2 hours of lecture. And then next week, on Tuesday, there's no lecture because of the symposium. And we'll make up for the with an extra hour of TA, probably on Thursday, but we will see. Okay, so our topic today is population coding. But I would like to remind you that last time we discussed, among other things, official information, and we saw that official information is a local measure of the sensitivity of the probability of the neural response or the probability distribution of the neural response to the stimulus, and it's formally related both to estimation problems through the Kramer-Rao bound. It provides a bound on the variance of an unbiased estimator, and it's also related to discrimination of fine between nearby stimuli. It tells us what is the probability of error of an optimal discriminator between two nearby stimuli. So now we would like to take this formalism and use it in a model of neural response. And we will start with a single neuron. And we will assume, as I already mentioned in the introduction to this topic, that the neuron is Poisson. So let's imagine that we have a single Poisson neuron. So our observations, if we observe the activity of the neuron, let's imagine that what we observe is the number of spikes that the neuron emitted. So it's a discrete observation. And now I'm telling you that this number is distributed as a Poisson process, meaning that the probability for n is e to the minus lambda to the n divided by n factorial. This is the Poisson distribution. But we imagine that this is the distribution of n conditioned on the stimulus. So the stimulus itself may affect this lambda. But for now, let's just discuss a few basic points about the Poisson distribution. Maybe I can continue a bit here. So if we just look at this distribution, then its mean is equal to lambda. I will, you know, if you don't know this, then you should check it. And the variance of this of n, what is the variance? It's also lambda. So let's just discuss two extreme cases when do you see what I'm writing here? Everyone?
No.
No? Okay. So I just want to discuss to remind ourselves how this distribution looks like in two extreme cases. One is when lambda is much smaller than one. Then how does the distribution look like? What would you expect to see for n when the lambda is very small?
Yep.
0, 1. I mean, essentially, that we can neglect. Okay, to the zeroth order, we could say that there's just no probability for a spike, but that's not interesting. But if we do want to take into account the occurrences of spikes, we can neglect the events in which n is 2 because their probability is much smaller than the events in which n is 1. So this approach is a process approach, what we call a Bernoulli process, which is just a binary process with two outcomes, and P of 1 is equal to lambda, P of 0 is equal to 1 minus lambda. So this is the case of n lambda much smaller than 1, and when lambda is much larger than 1, do you know how this process will look like? What the distribution, how it looks like when lambda is much larger than 1? So one way to kind of guess how it would look like is an observation that I'm not going to prove. But if you have a Poisson process with probability lambda, you can think about it as the sum of two Poisson processes with probabilities, independent Poisson processes with probability lambda over 2. Or, you know, m Poisson processes with probability lambda over m. Does that help in guessing how it will look like? Lambda is very large. Yeah. So you can think about when lambda is very large, you can think about the Poisson distribution as a sum of many independent smaller Poisson distributions with a smaller mean. And we know from the central limit theorem that when you do something like that, you get a normal distribution. On the other hand, it cannot really be a normal distribution because n is discrete, right? And it's not a continuous variable. So the way it looks like is, remember, the mean is lambda. Lambda doesn't have to be itself a natural number, you know, an integer. Translating incorrectly from Hebrew, and it doesn't have to be an integer. But and remember that the variance is lambda, so the standard deviation is square root of lambda, so it's small compared to lambda when lambda is large. And what we should draw is a Gaussian with width square root of lambda, but the distribution is discrete, so it will be something like this. And it's a nice exercise to prove mathematically that really this distribution approaches, can be, has this form when lambda is large. Okay, so all this is just a review of the Poisson process, but now we're really interested in a situation where the probability distribution depends on the stimulus. So again, I'm going to say that this is not really P of n, maybe we should even correct this and write it like this. This is P of n given lambda. but sorry, given theta. And lambda depends on theta. The mean depends on theta. So this is what we call the tuning curve. The mean number of spikes that a neuron emits depends on theta. It's some function of theta. Okay. So now, having defined this, we can ask what is official information. So we need to do this exercise. We need to take the formula for the official information. So let's first write down log p of n given theta. So we need to take the log of this thing. So it's minus lambda. Maybe I will already write lambda as f of theta, so it's minus f of theta plus n log of f of theta minus log of n factorial. And remember, we need to take derivatives of this quantity with respect to theta. So d to d theta of log p of n given theta, it's the derivative of this function with respect to theta, so it's minus f prime of theta plus n over f of theta times f prime of theta. And that's it, because this is not dependent on theta. And now, well, there are two ways to proceed, based on the two formulas that we wrote down for the official information. We can take this, square it, and take an average. Or I can take a second derivative, and then take an average. So I will proceed by taking the second derivative, but you can check that it works out also in the other way, if you want. So the second derivative of log p of n given theta to d theta square is, so here we just get the second derivative of this function, so it's minus f prime prime of theta. Here we have, we need to take the derivative both of 1 over f and of f prime. So we will get two terms. One of them will be minus n over f squared of theta times f prime of theta squared, right? We have minus f squared times f prime, and f prime multiplies also this f prime. And we have n divided by f of theta times f prime prime of theta. Okay. And now if I would want to be really, follow the notation of the formula that we wrote, the general formula that I wrote for the official information, I would write here in every place, theta prime, and then I evaluate this at the theta of interest, and I take an average over the distribution of n, because note that here in this expression we still have n, which is itself a random variable, right? This whole thing is a random variable. And now I want to take its average over the distribution of n given, p of n given, conditioned on theta. So this is what I need to do. I need to take minus d square log p of n given. I will write it down now using the more careful notation. So this is evaluated theta prime given theta and averaged over p of n given theta. Okay, so what will I get? So once I plug in theta prime equal theta, I get this expression. This is what I, right? And now I need to take the average over this, over this distribution. So this is not a number. It's not a random variable anymore. So it's just the average, it's just this number. What will I get here? When I average? What is, right, so the average, what, the only thing here which is a random variable is n. What is its average?
It is not
f of theta, lambda, which is f of theta. So I get here f prime of theta squared divided by f of theta. One f of theta was cancelled from n. And here, the same thing. So n, the average of n is f of theta, so I get plus f prime prime of theta. And now you can see that this cancels this. And so I'm left with the result that j, and there was a minus sign here. I put the minus sign here. So here there's no minus sign. Here there's no minus sign. And here there is a minus sign. Okay, and this cancels this. And so what we get is that j is equal to f prime of theta squared divided by f of theta. And this expression it makes sense in many ways, in several ways, which we will discuss now.
Can you repeat why on the derivation the f double prime of theta is unchanged?
Yeah, because we're thinking about this as a random variable. I mean, each time you have theta is fixed, each time you draw the response of the neuron, this thing has a certain value. The random part in it is really just n, right? This is just a number. Once the theta is fixed, this is a number. And its average is just itself. Okay, so now if you look at this expression, let's just notice a few things. For one thing, it's positive, right? By definition, the Poisson distribution lambda has to be positive, and we think about it as the mean number of spikes that the neuron emits. It has to be a positive thing. Here we have a square of something, so this is positive and this is positive, so j is positive. Or it's non-negative. Second, you see that it kind of has some reasonable features in it. It's proportional to the derivative of f with respect to theta squared. So if f, for example, suppose that f prime of theta is zero, meaning that the mean number of spikes that the neuron emits is locally insensitive to theta, then the Fisher information is zero. Then we will not be able to, we'll perform very poorly in any fine discrimination task. Or our ability to precisely estimate theta at that position will be very bad. So that's one thing. So if f prime of theta is zero, then j is equal to zero. Another thing to note is units. Remember from last time that the units of j have to be 1 over theta squared, 1 over the units of theta squared, and you can see that that's correct. F itself is dimensionless. It's a mean number of spikes, so it doesn't have any units. But the derivative with respect to theta gives us units of 1 over the units of theta, and it's squared. So the units are 1 over theta squared, which is what we should expect. And let's see if there's anything else. Yeah, the another question is, does the Fisher, suppose that the... Yeah, because the derivative with respect to theta gives you units of 1 over the units of theta, and it's squared. And f itself is dimensionless. It's a mean number of spikes. And finally, what happens if we just, we take a neuron with a certain tuning curve. This is f of theta, and we replace it by another neuron which has the same shape of the tuning curve, but it's just its firing rate or its mean number of spikes is multiplied by a factor. So let's suppose that we replace it by alpha f of theta, where alpha is larger than 1. Will the Fisher information increase or decrease? What do you expect? increase, right? I mean, one way to think about it is that if alpha goes to zero, so let's, you know, if we allow alpha to be both positive or negative, or larger than one or smaller than one, if alpha goes to zero, the neuron is not responsive at all, so obviously the Fisher information has to go to zero, so it has to decrease with alpha, at least if it's monotonic. So, but we can see that here. So if f goes to alpha f, then here we're multiplying by alpha square, here we're just multiplying by alpha, so j goes to alpha j. So if we increase keep the shape of the tuning curve fixed, but increase the mean by increase it by a factor, Fisher information increases by the same factor. And there's another way to think about this result, related to what I told you previously, that you can think about, suppose that you multiply f by 2. So the mean number of spikes increases by a factor of 2, but it's a property of the Poisson process that you can think about it as just the sum of two independent Poisson processes with mean f. Okay, if alpha is equal to 2, so you can think about it as you have 2f, you can think about the number of spikes as a sum of two independent Poisson processes with mean f, and we saw that when you sum up two independent variables, the Fisher information adds up. So this is this linearity is expected also based on that. All right, now, I made this assumption that the number of spikes is Poisson, but often we don't really think about the neuron as just, you know, emitting spikes. It's emitting spikes in time. It's generating a spike train. And often our model for, or, you know, simple model for the response of the neuron, it actually fires at a certain firing rate. It generates spikes with a certain rate, and maybe this number that we discussed here is really the number of spikes within some finite time window over which we measure the number of spikes. So I want to describe more formally this process that generates spikes in time. So before we continue with calculations of Fisher information, I want to discuss the concept of a point process. So a point process is actually any random process that is generating events which are just times, you know, defined by specific times of events. So one instantiation of a point process, and we think of these events in the context of neurons as the spikes. So one instantiation of the process would be, you know, a spike at time t2, a spike at time t1, a spike at time t2, a spike at time t3. And a particular instantiation of the process is just defined by a list of times in which the spikes occurred. So the most general description of a point process is to assign a probability to each sequence of spike times, which would be some probability function of the sequence, T1, T2, T3. So this is what is called a point process. Okay? And now we want to discuss the Poisson process. I would do it in this way. It's a point process with the following properties. I will use the language of spikes, just because it's what we're interested in, but you can call it events. P, the probability to have a spike in the interval t plus dt approaches lambda tt for small dt. Okay, so if you observe a very small time interval of the process and ask what is the probability to have a spike, at least one spike in that interval, first of all, this probability will go to zero as you take the interval to zero, and when the interval is small, the probability will be proportional to the duration of the interval, and this is a proportionality constant. So note that lambda has units of 1 over time, because this is a probability, so it has units of rate. The units of lambda is 1 over time, units of rate. And the second property is that the probability of I will write it a little bit sloppily. The probability distribution in non-overlapping intervals, t plus delta t prime plus delta t prime. So if you take any two intervals which are non-overlapping, the probability distribution for the spike trains observed in these two intervals are completely independent. But this goes through to any two intervals, and it goes through also to very small intervals. So if you ask what is the probability to have a spike in a very small interval here, and then you take another small interval right next to it, it's completely independent. Okay? So these two properties define the Poisson process. Maybe I should add to this one that given that when dt goes to zero, this really becomes in this small interval, this becomes the Bernoulli process, so the p of no spike approaches 1 minus lambda dt.
So neurons fire non-Poisson because they have a refractory period.
That's absolutely correct. So a real neuron is never Poisson. It cannot, so a Poisson process can have two spikes at, at an interval which is arbitrarily small, and real neurons do not. But oftentimes, when you measure activity of neurons, say in the cortex, you see that the spike trains are over a wide range of timescales, they are well approximated by a Poisson process. Okay, so one comment is that in this definition, I assume that lambda is just a constant in time, but you can just as well define the so-called inhomogeneous Poisson process in which lambda depends on the specific time. But for now, we look at the case where lambda is constant. And now a very important property of the Poisson process is that if you look at the number of spikes in any interval, t plus delta t, this itself is the random variable, and it is distributed as a Poisson variable. So this is Poisson with mean lambda, which is equal to lambda delta t. Okay. And it has to be that way, because we know that when delta t is very small, by this definition, it has to be lambda delta t. And because of this property, we can take the interval and split it into very small intervals, each one, infinitesimally small, and then the mean will be just the sum over the means of each one. But this is goes through also to the variance, because the spikes are independent, so the variance simply add up. And I will not prove that it's distributed Poisson, but it's correct. Maybe we'll have an exercise on it. And so, you know, n is equal to lambda delta t, and the n squared, and for the variance of n is equal also to lambda delta t. Okay, so now let's imagine that our model is that our neurons fired as a Poisson process with a rate lambda which depends on theta on the stimulus. And second, we observe the spikes in interval delta t, then if we connect this model to what we've done previously when we discussed the Poisson process, then what we called f of theta is really lambda of theta times delta t. And therefore, you see that the Fisher information is equal to, I already erased the expression, but we have had f prime squared divided by f. So we just need to replace f prime by lambda times delta t. Delta t we will have with a square in the numerator and without a square in the denominator, so we will have the power of 1 of delta t. And we'll get lambda prime of theta squared divided by lambda of theta times delta t. So, first of all, in terms of units, everything is okay because lambda has units of 1 over time. Remember, this is what we not brought here. Lambda has units of 1 over time, so we have 1 over time squared times time, because this is 1 over 1 over time, and times time. So that the units of time cancel out, and we remain only with the units of 1 over theta squared from the derivative here. And so you see that the Fisher information is proportional to the length of the interval of observation. The longer we observe, collect more spikes, the Fisher information increases. And so, for example, if you construct an unbiased estimator of theta based on the activity of this neuron, then the variance of this estimator will be proportional to 1 over time, delta t. Now, strictly speaking, it's not really true, because I'm using here the Kramer-Rao bound, which is just a bound. But when delta t is sufficiently long, our observation is a sum over independent observations, and when we have many of them, the Kramer-Rao bound is saturated. So for sufficiently large delta t, we're actually assured that the variance of an unbiased estimator will decrease as 1 over delta t. Now, there's actually some subtlety that I kind of glossed over. I cheated in some way, in one way, in what I told you. Or, you know, I didn't address a certain subtlety. Our observation is the observations of the spikes, right? Now I took these spikes and I asked what is the distribution of the number of spikes in the interval, right? And then I asked what is the Fisher information in that observation. So suppose that I tell you about, so really what The fissure information that I wrote here is in the observation of the number of spikes. But there's more detail in the observation than the number of spikes. Maybe if I tell you what is the specific times, what are the specific times in which a neuron has fired, maybe you'll be able to do better in using that information to estimate theta than if I tell you just what was the total number of spikes. Right? It's not the same thing. I could tell you, you know, that there was a spike at this time, and this a spike at this time. Or I could just tell you that there were three spikes. So if I tell you that there are three spikes, I'm throwing away some information about the observation. And the Fisher information that we calculated here is really the Fisher information embodied in the number of spikes. So does that matter?
But you can't value it for some process. You don't really care of location spikes because you're giving...
Okay, very good. So it's very important to understand that there's a difference between these two quantities for a general point process. For example, suppose that we had a process where the if a neuron, you know, the neuron might fire the spike, but if the stimulus is sufficiently large, it will always fire bursts of spikes very close to each other. Then having several spikes close to each other might mean something different than, you know, having a spike and then another spike and another spike at some different time. So in general, there is more information, there could be more information in the precise spike times about the stimulus than if I just tell you what is the number of spikes. So a Poisson's process is special. Okay, a Poisson's process is special because, so my question, so let me just write down the question and try to write this down on the whiteboard. So the question is, why only number of spikes? Why do I care only about that? So for Poisson process, the formal statement is that if I ask you what is the probability of a certain pattern of spike times within some interval, you can show that this is only a function of the number of spikes. You can formally show that any pattern of spikes in which you have the same number of spikes has the same probability. Okay? This is a special property of the Poisson process. The technical term in statistics is that n is what is called a sufficient statistic for theta. Meaning that you don't lose any information about theta by collapsing this very high dimensional, you know, observation at the specific times of the spike into one variable, which is the total number of spikes. So n is a sufficient statistic. And because of this, actually, if I tell you, you know, the specific times, that does not provide you any additional information about theta, because again, different patterns with different timings of the spikes have the same probability. So I will not be able to, we cannot learn anything new about theta by if I specify to you what were the number of spikes. Okay. So this is one comment. And I would like to repeat two comments that I said in words and just write them down. So I ask why J proportional to delta T, and the reason is that we can think about the observation of the number of spikes in an interval delta t as the combination of the number of spikes in two subintervals of duration delta t over 2, and we know that the observations are independent because the Poisson process is defined by the fact that the spike train in one interval and in another over a non-overlapping interval is independent. So necessarily J of delta t has to be equal to J over delta t over 2 plus J over... Yeah, okay. Okay, so j of theta, let's put here a semicolon delta t to just remind ourselves that it also depends on the delta t, sorry, theta delta t over 2 plus j of theta delta t over 2, and a function that has this property, and you can also, you know, so this is, which this is 2 times j of theta delta t over 2. So if we think about j as a function of delta t, now we fix theta and think about it as a function of delta t, a function that has this property, and here I use the independence, right? A function that has this property has to obey this, has to be linear in delta t. And the other, another statement that I made is that when delta t is large, then we essentially have a sum over independent observations, and the Kramer-Rao bound becomes saturated. And therefore the variance of an optimal unbiased estimator will be proportional to 1 over delta t. Okay, I think this is, I'll do one more thing and then we'll take a break. So far we discussed one neuron. And now we can immediately generalize this to a population of neurons which are independently firing conditioned on the stimulus. So we can have a population of independent Poisson neurons. And our model can be that each one of these neurons has a different tuning curve, and we observe the firing of these neurons over some time interval delta t. So there are Poisson processes with rates lambda I delta t, lambda I of theta, and our observation will be the number of spikes. So if we want to write down the official information conveyed about theta by the activity of the whole population, because these are independent variables, it's just additive. So official information is going to be sum over I fi prime of theta squared divided by fi of theta. And in the next questions that I'm going to address, I'm going to use this notation because I just don't want to carry the delta t all the time, but you should have in mind that we really imagine that a neuron is a Poisson process and we're observing the number of spikes in some interval. Okay, so let's take a break, continue afterwards.
slave somewhere there. So that slave where you wrote it, he didn't like emphasize that it's only approximately for larger people. So I think that was a place I said something like that. Because what's actually true is that this is a larger, like this direction. So this is larger than other people because of the grammar outbound. But I think we also we mentioned with Tali, he didn't specify, but it seems like I think Tali emphasized like talking about more that in the grammar outbound when you have more and more observations that are independent, that it gets closer and closer to the fact that it's not only larger, it's like almost it. So that would be beauty. He said for large SSD you have more and more independent observations. So you're getting closer and closer to the actual value. I think that was qualified. It's like he kind of said it fast and then he repeated it, so it doesn't seem like something that he completed. I don't know, because he said it was. As well, so he is the length of the entire program. Yeah. And it's the number of pages. Thank you.
מתאימים שוב לתחולת המבחנים אפשר בשבוע. אוקיי. איך יש מיוצבים זה? תפשור, איך יש מיוצבים זה קורה?
אבל אני חושב שכולם
יסכימו. כן, אבל בצורה לא צריך שצריך דבר ראשון לתת.
ברור שכן.
שאלה איך להתניין, מאיזה כיוון.
אני חושב שקודם כל בזה שתשלחו לי או לנטע, תגידו איזה תאריכים נראים לכם טובים. כן, ואולי עדיף יותר מתאריך אחד, כדי שאפשר לסדר עדיפות, אבל שכאילו לנו לא משהו לא מסדר, שנגיד שניים, שלושה תאריכים אפשריים, שיכול להיות עם סדר עדיפות.
פשוט בא לסגור את זה מראש, כדי לדעת תאריך הסופי,
לי יש איזו נסיעה ממש בסוף
המבחנים?
בסוף ממש בסוף של תקופת המבחנים, אבל אם זה לפני זה, אז לא אמור להיות בעיה. אוקיי, טוב. We discussed the official information for population and independent for some years. This is the expression. And now I want to discuss an important model for the response of a population. And this is a population with translationally invariant dense adaptive field that I'll explain in a moment. So our model is that we have a stimulus, which for convenience I will assume is a linear, you know, is assumes a certain range of values between 0 and L. So this is theta. This is the stimulus. And now I'm going to draw the firing rate for several neurons, maybe for two, yeah, for several. So the idea is that if we look at the tuning curve of one particular neuron, it might look like this, and this would be the tuning curve for one particular neuron with respect to theta. And then if I will look at other neurons, if we look at other neurons, they will have the same shape of the tuning curve but translated. So they will be responsive to different, each neuron will be responsive to, most responsive to a different value of theta, but with the same shape of the tuning curve. So this is, these are different, the tuning curves of different neurons. And so mathematically I can say that fi of theta is equal to some function of theta minus theta I. Well, theta I is the value of theta to which the particular neuron I maximally tuned at the moment. It's maximally responsive for that theta I. Other than that, I'm not going to make particular assumptions about the shape of this function, except that for reasons that you will see in a moment, I'm going to assume that these tuning curves are narrow compared to the whole range of theta. Okay? So they're compact, and they're narrow compared to the full range. It's straightforward to instead of doing it in the way that I'm doing it here, to imagine that theta is periodic, but it would be more convenient for me to look at the range from 0 to L. And this model is really motivated by observations in many brain areas. So for periodic variables, you know, responses to orientation tuning in V1, head direction cells are like that. If we think about a continuous variable which is not periodic, maybe place cells in the hippocampus, have, you know, each place cell has a tuning curve which is localized, but different cells are responsive to different positions.
They have all the same shape?
No. Okay, so this is the idealization, but we want to discuss first the idealization. And so on. The other examples. Frequency tuning. Okay, so what can we say about the official information? So we define the responses of our neurons, and for the sake of our model, we're going to assume that the neurons are, the theta i's are uniformly sampling the range 0 to n, and I will even go a step further and imagine that they're really, you know, in uniform steps, so theta I minus theta I is going to be equal to delta theta, and because we are covering the whole range L, and we imagine that we have n neurons, then this delta theta will be L over the number of neurons. And so now you can see why I call this model in the way that I did. Translationally invariant means that the shape is invariant to, you know, that you have, the neurons have the same shape of tuning curve but with translation. And by dense I mean that delta theta is sufficiently small, and you will see in a moment why that's important. So I assume that the coverage is dense. So let's evaluate official information. Before we do the math, in general, Fisher information is a function of theta, right? Depends on the, you know, this sum depends on, can depend on theta. What can we say about the dependence in theta in this model?
It will be constant, yeah, in the Fisher information.
Okay, so what you're saying is correct under some assumptions, or under which some of which would make. In what cases, when will it not necessarily be constant, or when will it not necessarily be constant? Okay, so one place where the Fisher information might depend on theta is at the edges, because, you know, each neuron here essentially sees the same pattern of responses, sorry, not neuron, each stimulus here has a set of neurons that respond to it in the same way after translation, but once we get into the edges, we don't have the neurons here, so Fisher information might deviate from this uniformity at the edges, and this is why I assumed that the tuning curves are narrow compared to the whole range, so that, you know, the edge effect will be just a small part of the range, but in the middle it will be uniform. The other reason that the Fisher information might not be uniform is if the tuning curves are not sufficiently dense. Then, of course, you know, if you have one neuron with this response and the next neuron is like that, the tuning curve will not, the Fisher information will not be the same here and here. Fine, but we are going to assume that we're in the middle of the range somewhere, not close to the edges, and the tuning curve and the coverage is dense. So then, let's see what the math tells us. So we can write J as sum over I F prime of theta minus theta I squared divided by F theta minus theta I.
But then zero, no?
What?
Because the derivative by theta at every point.
Well, you have a square of the derivative, so this is not zero, this is never zero. Unless it will be zero for those neurons which are completely non-responsive, so unless it was. Okay, now what can we do with such a sum under the assumptions that I... No, the neurons are not the same, but it's a sum over something like this, you know, theta. What can we do with it? Theta is going to, theta I is a close, you know, dense point along this line.
Can approximate it by an integral?
Yes, okay, so we can approximate the sum by an integral. So we can write that this is approximately equal to delta theta. If I want to approximate it by delta theta, what I want to do is, approximate it by integral, I want to multiply by delta theta, so this will be like the value of the function, where I think about it as a function of theta I, and I multiply the value of this function by the interval. So I will write down 1 over delta theta times delta theta, and now I have delta theta times this sum. I will not write it again. And this is really the approximation for the integral, right? And this approximation becomes good when delta theta is small. So this is why we have to assume that the tuning curves are dense. And so this would become equal to 1 over delta theta times the integrals. Now, in principle, I would need to take the limits of the integral from 0 to L. These are the theta I. These are the preferred stimuli of the different neurons. So this goes from 0 to L. Okay, let's write it that way for now. And now this is just S prime theta minus theta I squared divided by F of theta minus theta I d theta itself. Now, sorry, not theta I now, but let's call it theta prime. This is my integration variable. But now, I remember that I'm looking at a neuron which is somewhere over here. Sorry, not a neuron, a stimulus which is somewhere over here. And so once I go to neurons whose receptive field is far from this stimulus, this decays, so they don't respond. And so I might as well continue the integration to infinity and to minus infinity. I might as well imagine that that my neurons don't stop here. There are an infinite number of neurons going all the way, because anyway they wouldn't respond. Yeah. So I can replace this integral, and then once I do that, I can also redefine theta minus theta prime as my integration variable, and so I can replace this. As long as I'm not close to the edges, I can replace this by 1 over delta theta, an integral from minus into infinity to infinity, f prime of theta square divided by f of theta d theta.
Can you please explain again the change of boundaries? Well, how can you extend to infinity?
Well, because I assume that these tuning curves decay to zero sufficiently fast that neurons that are far away from the stimulus don't contribute.
Ah, so don't care to some.
So I can add as many as I want, here they don't respond anyway. So. Okay, so, and the last thing that I just want to do is to remember that 1 over delta theta is n over L. So, this is n over L, an integral from minus infinity to infinity, f prime of theta squared divided by f of theta, d theta. Just I define theta minus theta prime to be my or theta prime minus theta if you want to be my integration. Theta is 6. Theta is the place where I'm evaluating the Fischer information. Theta prime is my integration variable, so I could have written here minus theta prime, you know, it's just I would this theta is theta prime minus theta. Okay. So strictly speaking I should have written minus here. Switch it then. Okay. Not there. You can convince yourself that this is correct.
So efficient information won't be
okay, so you see now that let's actually write this, let's call this theta prime. Just to make this clear. This is my integration variable. You see that theta dropped out. Right? So indeed, as we expect, we get an answer which is independent of theta. Now, one other thing to note is that I assume that the neurons are really uniformly sampling this range, and that was important. We don't have to, once they're dense, it's not so important to assume that they have precisely uniform differences in the receptive field. What is really important is that you have dense coverage and uniform coverage. And you see now that if we add more and more neurons to the mix, to this population, while maintaining this uniformity, then the Fischer information will be proportional to the number of neurons, okay, or to the density in which we add neurons.
Okay, well, the feeling makes sense, the math and what you're confused with it. Where does the theta disappear?
Okay, so
which step?
So here, I could have written this still as
you know, let's do it. Let's call, let's write it like this, and define theta tilde to be theta prime minus theta. Or theta, you know, we'll do it theta minus theta prime. That's okay. So theta tilde will be theta minus theta prime. So here you have theta tilde, you have theta tilde, the range of integration of theta tilde is now from infinity to minus infinity, but d theta tilde is minus d theta prime, so when we correct for that, we get.
Theta tilde is dependent on theta.
Yes, but because it's going from minus infinity to infinity, doesn't matter. So I mean the range theta tilde, so theta prime went from minus infinity to infinity. Theta tilde also goes from infinity to minus infinity, or you can switch it from minus infinity. And so theta doesn't matter anymore. You see, it doesn't enter explicitly here because we replace now theta minus theta prime by theta tilde. And the range of integration, the fact that it's shifted by, because it's from minus infinity to infinity, the fact that it's shifted by theta doesn't matter. It's still minus infinity to infinity.
Just call it just a shift.
Yeah. All right. But it should make sense that what this is really conveying is the fact that wherever you are here, you have, you know, an equivalent set of neurons with the same properties of response relative to where you are. Okay, so this is our result. And now I want to pose a question. Suppose that we are allowed to vary the shape of this tuning curve. And in particular, what I will be interested in now is that I fix the shape, the general shape, suppose that it's a Gaussian or some function, but I can make it more narrow or more wide. Okay? So, is it better to make it narrow or wide? That's my question.
That's how many neurons.
Okay,
so true for wide.
What? Well, yeah, but we can still, if you have enough neurons, you might be still able to make the tuning curve more narrow or more wide, and still maintain
the range of narrow.
Yeah, yeah. Okay? So, so the question that I would like to ask is whether it's good to have narrow or wide receptive fields from the perspective of code, of decoding. I mean, from the perspective of how easy will it be to use these neurons, the activity of these neurons to precisely measure theta or discriminate between phi and theta. Okay, so our model is that we fix the number of neurons. Theta is in the range 0 to L as before. But let's assume that I write f of theta as some function g of theta over s. And s will set the scale of the tuning curve. So, if s, I can have different values of s. If I plot here, f of theta as a function of theta, then in one case I will have a certain tuning curve. I'm trying to draw this symmetric, and it's with a different value of f, might have the same shape but wider. So this will be the case for small s. Like s, the range of theta over which this function decays, so small s will be narrow tuning curve, and large
would be a wider
tuning curve. So this is okay, very good. So this is an important question. In what I assume, the way I wrote it here, I assume that the maximum firing rate, if this is, you know, right, we have in mind a tuning curve which has a maximum and one maximum, so the maximum firing rate remains the same. That's very important. I could have decided to use some other criterion.
Is there any, reason for
tuning? Well, okay, so this has to do, you know, with, to some extent, to a question of what are the constraints on the neural activity. Okay, so it's a good question. I mean, maybe there's a constraint on single neurons. You know, single neurons cannot fire beyond 100 Hz, so that would be a reason to set this maximum to be constant. But on the other hand, you might say the real constraint is on the total number of spikes generated by the population. And then maybe if you make the neural response wider, then you want to shift to move down the peak so that the total number of spikes will be conserved. So. Very good question, but now just for the sake of this calculation, of this exercise, we're going to assume that the peak firing rate is conserved. But it's the typical thinking about neurons in the cortex is that they have peak maximal firing rates of around 10 Hz. So there's a typical firing rate of neurons in the cortex. Other sensory might be higher. Okay, so anyway, but we're doing a mathematical exercise now. I'm not trying to understand, fully understand the coding in the brain. We just want to understand what the theory says. So, okay, so now the question is whether it's good under these rules of the game. So, what I change is the width while keeping the sum maximum firing rate fixed. Is it good or bad to make the neurons to have a narrow tuning curve? What do you think? What do you think will be better?
You said that n is the constant, the number
yes,
of neurons?
Yes, yes.
And you assume that also for the narrow one, what we said before? Oh,
right. So I'm assuming all the discussion is in a regime in which the n is sufficiently large that the coverage will be dense. So even as I make them narrow, at some point, if I keep n fixed and make the tuning curves more and more narrow, we'll break that assumption. But I'm assuming that I'm not yet there. Okay, I have dense coverage, and I'm making the tuning curves more narrow. Yes?
So narrow sounds better, because then you have, you know by the new one which trials most, what the estimate is.
Okay. By the way,
there would be more variability.
Right. Okay. So the neurons, if it's more narrow, the sensitivity of the firing of each neuron to the stimulus becomes larger, but it's not precisely correct because it's true for those neurons that are responding, for which the stimulus is in the range of the receptive field. So you know, for some neurons, like the neurons which is here, maybe if I actually make it narrow, I will lose, this neuron responds to this stimulus, and it's still sensitive to it. But as I make the tuning curve more narrow, it stops to respond. So it's not also that obvious. On one hand, for the neurons that are still, for which the stimulus is in the area of the receptive field, they're more sensitive, right? But the number of neurons that are actually responding to the stimulus goes down. So there's an interplay between two competing effects. So let's see what the math tells us. So I'm going to write the Fisher information as n over l, an integral d theta from minus infinity to infinity, 1 over g of theta over f, d to d theta, g of theta over f, squared d theta, and this is equal to n over l, integral d theta 1 over g theta over f. Now, when I take the derivative here, it's a derivative of a compound function, so I have to take the internal derivative, which is 1 over f,
at G prime at theta over S. Okay, so we'll have 1 over S squared here, but now I also want to define my an integration variable, which I will call X, and just redefine the integration variable. So X is theta over S, will be theta over S, so dx, d theta is d, is S dx. So when I do that, I will have here from 1s, and from here I have the 1 over s squared. So I will have altogether 1 over s times n over l integral dx. What is the range of integration of x? It's also minus infinity to infinity. And now I have here 1 over g of x, g prime of x squared. And this is just a number. This does not depend on x. So you see here that we get something which is proportional to 1 over s. What does that mean? Yeah, the smaller s, the better. We want to make the tuning curves narrower. Do we want to make them infinitely narrow? If n is fixed.
As long as
they're densely covering the range. So at some point, if we make s smaller and smaller, we break the assumption that the tuning curves are dense. And then this whole calculation breaks down, and in fact, efficient summation would stop increasing. It would also be a function of theta in that case. Because what happens is once the tuning curves are sufficient, too narrow, it depends on whether you're in a regime where you have a neuron which is responding. Well, efficient summation might be very good, but in other areas, you will not have any, no neuron will respond, so the efficient summation will be zero. So once we make the tuning curve sufficiently narrow, we have to define also what do we care about? Do we care about the average Fisher information, or do we maybe, it's very bad for us to have values of theta for which the Fisher information is zero, then certainly it's not good.
It's somewhat related to intuition. How from this definition you see that large S will have a broad tuning curve and smaller,
This is just this definition. By definition, if I set f of theta to be g of theta over s, then this is how it works out. How large should, so suppose that g decays over some characteristic range of theta, s will really set how distant I should be from the center of the receptive field for g to start to go down. So this is how an intuitive way to think about it.
Can you please repeat again, how do you see from here the trade-off of s? Too large,
I don't see clearly the trade-off in this expression, in what I did. What I see is that in the end, I want to make S small.
But it's not small.
There are two things that I talked about. One is that there is a trade-off. The trade-off is played out in this expression, and I will discuss it further a bit later, that you benefit from the fact that the tuning curves are narrow, from the fact that this F prime, you can actually see it in the calculation, that here, you see that the benefit is coming from this 1 over S squared. When you make S smaller...
No, it's fine. So just have the J bigger. So it's fine.
Exactly. The single neuron J is bigger, but you have a smaller number of neurons that are responding to a stimulus, and that is really essentially the reason why it's not 1 over S squared, but there's an S here also that came from the change of variable. That's one issue. That's a trade-off. But you see here that the sensitivity of the single neurons wins over the fact that you have a smaller number of neurons at this point. Okay? That's a trade-off. The second thing that I said is, okay, according to this calculation, we should make S as small as we can make J infinite by letting S approach zero, but this is not really true because we are fixing the number of neurons. And at some point, as S becomes smaller and smaller, we will break the assumption that the coverage is uniform. And once that's true, I will not be able to write down this expression for the efficient information, which I derived here by sw- by replacing the sum with an integral. But when I used, okay, when I did it, I used the fact that it's a step. Okay, so, that's the conclusion. But now what I want to do is to generalize this to the case of multidimensional stimuli. So for example, if we think of places in the hippocampus, then the receptive fields are a function of a two-dimensional variable, position in a two-dimensional space. You can think of other generalizations to stimuli which are not one-dimensional. Now, in order to even discuss multidimensional stimuli, we need to generalize some of the things that we did for one-dimensional stimuli to multidimensional stimuli. So let's discuss multidimensional stimuli a bit, and then we'll go back to this question of narrow versus wide tuning curves. So imagine now that theta is not a scalar, it's a vector. With dimensionality m. Okay. So we have neural responses that depend on this vector. So can we generalize the Kramer-Raba and the statement about the discriminability to this case? So it turns out that yes, and everything that we did, you know, remember that both in estimation and discrimination, the Fisher information came up. And for example, if we discuss estimation, we had the Kramer-Raba bound, and it was related to the Fisher information. So there was a generalization of the Kramer-Raba bound for multidimensional stimuli, which involves a generalization of the Fisher information. So the Fisher information, which was a scalar in the one-dimensional case, is now a matrix. Often it's called a tensor, but it doesn't matter. It's a matrix. It has, if you know, if we have m, the dimensionality of the stimulus is m, then this is an m by m matrix. And the entries of this matrix are defined in similarity to our definition of the Fisher information for a single variable. Let's write it carefully. Theta prime alpha, theta prime beta, log p evaluated. This is, you can see that if we're in one dimension, then necessarily alpha and beta are the same index, one, and then it's just the second derivative of log p of r given theta. So we go back to the second definition that I wrote for the Fisher information. But this is the generalization, and the Kramer-Raba bound tells us the following. In that case, alpha and beta, you know, there's just one, m is one, so alpha and beta are necessarily one, it's a scalar.
Oh, you can only use the first definition
when you go. Oh, no, you can also write it in terms of the first definition. As a, you know, the first definition was a product, was a square, so here we have a product,
there's
a respect to alpha, there's a respect to beta. Okay, so the Kramer-Raba bound. Again, we have this issue of where is the, I think it's like this. Kramer-Raba bound tells us the following. So what it tells us is that now we're discussing an estimator of this vector. So you observe that there are the responses, and you want to estimate the whole
the whole vector, and you can write the mean squared error of the vector, the sum of the squared errors for all the entries. But you can also look at, so what do we quantify when we look at an estimator? You can look what is the variance, what is the mean squared error for each particular entry. You estimate theta 1 up to theta m, what is the mean squared error for theta 1, what is the mean squared error for theta 2. You can also look at covariances, what is the covariance of your error in theta 1 and theta 2. So in principle, we might be interested in this whole covariance matrix. So let me write things and then I will explain. So the Kramer-Rao bound tells us that E minus J minus 1 is at least as large as 0, but there are several things that we need to explain here. First of all, what is written here is an M by M matrix. This also is an M by M matrix. Well, good question. So J is a positive definite matrix.
That can't be positive.
Yeah, and then it's not invertible. And this is the same as the fact that if in the scalar case, if J equals 0, your variance is infinite. So essentially, it's the same thing. But at least it's okay. That's a good question. And but I didn't define E yet, so I don't know really what I wrote here, and I also didn't explain what I'm writing, what does this mean for a matrix, so I should explain all this. So first of all, E alpha beta is really the covariance matrix of errors, so it's delta alpha minus the true alpha beta beta minus theta beta, that's what it is. So, for example, the alpha-alpha entry of E alpha-beta would be the mean square error of our estimate for theta-alpha. Okay? So these are the diagonal terms. But we also, this involves the covariances of the errors in different directions. And this is the inverse of this matrix. And when I'm saying that this matrix, the matrix is larger or equal to zero, what I mean by that is that really that this matrix is a positive definite matrix, semi-positive definite matrix. E minus J minus 1, semi-positive definite. This is what I mean when I write this. Now, one of the properties of a semi-positive definite matrix is that all its elements along the diagonal are non-negative, right? So one of the conclusions that we can reach from this, it's not the whole thing, but it's one of the conclusions, is that E alpha alpha minus J minus 1 alpha alpha is at least as large as 0. These are the diagonal elements. And so E alpha alpha is at least as large as the alpha alpha element J minus 1. And But it turns out that for positive definite matrices, we can also show mathematically, and I'll leave this as an exercise, either Netta will do it with you in class or we will do it at home, that for positive definite matrices, you can also, they always obey a property that this is at least as large as J alpha alpha to the minus 1. This, here I use the positive definiteness of J, which I didn't prove, but it's true, so maybe this will also be an exercise. Now,
what does it mean when it's a matrix that it's positive definite?
What?
We can have like an element that's not positive?
Yes, so positive definite matrices can definitely have elements which are not positive, but there are several ways to define a positive definite matrix. We mentioned this already in the course. One of them is that if you make a sandwich with any vector, right, you multiply from the left with the vector and multiply from the right from the same vector, you will always get a non-negative answer. This is a semi-positive definite. The other way is if the matrix is you can diagonalize the matrix, and for symmetric matrices you can always do it, and the eigenvalues are real, then all the eigenvalues are non-negative or positive, depending if we're discussing semi-positive definite or positive. Okay, so now this is math. This is just a math, and this result is interesting in several ways that I want to discuss. So one is that if you go back to the one-dimensional case, you see that this is really the Kramer R bound as we know it from the last lesson. But this mathematical relationship. Has an intuitive meaning in the context of estimation theory. So I would like to discuss what each one of these inequalities means. This inequality is a strict inequality that we got from the Kramer-Rao bound. This is what the Kramer-Rao bound is telling us. Now, what is the scenario here? The scenario here is that you observe R, and your role, your goal, is to estimate all the entries here, theta 1 up to theta 1. You don't know any one of them. And this is what you need to do. Right? You can think about another scenario. Let's imagine that alpha is 1, okay, theta 1. Suppose that your goal is only to estimate theta 1, and I tell you what is theta 2, what is theta 3, what is theta 4, up to theta m. I just don't tell you what is theta 1, and you observe r, and you want to estimate theta 1. Will you do better or worse than in the case when I don't tell you any one of the theta? Of course you'll do better. This quantifies, this is really the official information with respect to the single variable, theta 1, assuming that you know theta 2 up to theta m. So this really quantifies how, you know, when you were going to do in a situation where you know, I tell you what is theta 2 up to theta m, and you just need to estimate theta 1. And this is the bound that we have in a situation where you don't know any one of them. So this is really mathematics, tells us what we understood intuitively, that you will do worse. Your variance would be worse in the case where you need to estimate all the variables, specifically for theta 1. Okay, your variance, your error for theta 1 would be worse if you don't know theta 2 up to theta n than in a situation where you do know. Okay, so this is just an interpretation of this part of the inequality.
Is it specifically theta alpha?
Sure. Alpha is just a choice of saying alpha can be 1, 2, 3, 4, up to n. Any one. All right, so I think I will steal just a few more minutes to finish this topic and go back now to narrow versus wide tuning curve in the M dimension.
Would be
now this is only the Kramer-Raab language involved the Fisher. So the Fisher information would be this quantity, the inverse of this quantity is smaller than this one, so this quantity is larger.
Okay.
So, narrow versus wide tuning curves in three dimensions, in n dimensions. For example, the dimensionality could be two for placements in two dimensions, or three for placements in bats, which are three dimensions. So, we have, again, translationally invariant dense receptive fields, and J alpha beta, the Fisher information matrix, is going to be okay. Now we need to be a little bit careful. So imagine that the range of the stimulus is in a box, m dimensional box, and in each dimension it goes from 0 to L. So L over delta theta, and we uniformly place neurons with preferred stimuli in this box. So L over theta, delta theta, is the number of discretization points in each direction, and the total number of discretization points is therefore this to the power, let's instead of n dimensions, I will use d. So this is the m that we had before, and therefore, the number of discretization points is, for example, in two dimensions, if we have a certain number L over delta theta here, L over delta theta here, then the number of points on this grid will be L over delta theta to the power 2. In D dimension, it will be L over delta theta to the power D. So this will be the number of neurons. And therefore, delta theta to the power D is equal to L to the power D over N. And now why is this important? Because when we switched from a sum to an integral, in one dimension we have to divide and multiply by delta theta. In the d-dimensional case, we have to divide and multiply by delta theta to the power d. So this ends up, I'm not going to do it with all the details, everything is similar to what we did in one dimension, but we have this 1 over delta theta to the power d, which is n divided by n to the d, and then we have an integral. And the integral is to d to the d theta, d alpha s, d, actually this should, yeah, d alpha s, d, al- d beta s divided by s. This is for the alpha beta entry of j alpha beta. In the one dimensional case, it was always alpha was equal to beta equal to 1, so this was just the
what did you say after the integral?
What?
D to the power of D?
Yes. This is D dimension.
It's
D dimensional, the D dimensional integral. Okay, so now now consider F of theta, which is equal to G of theta over S. So again, we can tune the width of our tuning curve by varying S. And now I will not do everything in detail. I will leave this as an exercise for you. But it's very similar to what we did in one dimension, except that some of the things will be different, because when we do the change of variables here, we'll have a different power of S that enters in the change of variables. And if we do, in the end, you get that J alpha beta is proportional to S to the power D minus 2. So in one dimension, when D is equal to 1, we get 1 over S. Remember, that was the prefactor that we got in one dimension. Okay, so D equal to 1. J is proportional to 1 over F. Narrow tuning curves beta. If we take D equals 3, for example, or anything which is larger than 2, but for example, for D equal 2, we now get that the fish information is proportional to F. It's not proportional to 1F over F. So it's actually better to make the tuning delta wide. And D equals 2 is actually special. In D equal 2, it doesn't matter. There's no dependence. So you have this population of neurons, you can make the tuning curves wider or narrow, as long as they're narrow compared to the range, and densely covering the range, it doesn't really matter what is the width that you choose. And I want to go back to the statement that there are two competing effects. One is that the fish information improves because the sensitivity of each neuron to the stimulus, each new responsive neuron to the stimulus, becomes better, but it degrades because the number of neurons that are responding goes down. And so in one dimension, what wins is the single neuron response, but in three dimensions, what wins is the fact that the total number of neurons that are responding, if we make the tuning curve narrow, it goes down more fast, and therefore it's better to make the tuning with the curves wide. Yes.
Just take the limits of large S, then what breaks is the assumption, the change of bound?
Exactly. So what will break down if you make the tuning curve very wide is that eventually all your neurons will be in this place, and this is actually not a good place to be. The neurons are responsive to stimuli which are not at the center. The fish information is better if you're not precisely at the center of the receptive field. Okay, so and one other last comment, I'm really stealing too much time, so one last comment is that going back to your question, the rules of the game that I defined were that as I'm changing the width of the tuning curve, I'm keeping the maximal firing rate fixed. I could have decided to keep the total population rate, total rate of spikes on the whole population fixed. In that case, for the wider tuning curves, I would have needed to reduce the maximum firing rate in order to keep the number of spikes fixed. And in that case, all this is not correct. In that case, it's always better to make the tuning curves narrower. Okay? That's just a comment. All right, so that's it for today. Probably the next lecture will be 2 weeks from now, because next week it will probably be 2 hours. Tuesday there's no class, Thursday probably 2 hours from here.
כשאתה עושה את זה אחת, הרבה יותר נוירונים מגיבים לסטימולוס שלך.
זה היה גם בראשון.
נכון, אז בשלושה ממדים האפקט הזה יותר חזק. כי יש לך נוירונים מכל הכיוון, כאילו מכל הממדים ש...
כן, אבל זה נשמע לי שגם אם זה היה צר, אז היה לך...
אז אוקיי, אז זה...
כאילו נצא בתוך ה...
זה כאילו הרווח שלך, שכמות הנוירונים שמגיבים, הוא הולך כחזקה אחרת של ה... בגלל ש... ששוב, בממד אחד אתה... אתה עושה לי יותר רחב, אז זה לינארי, שלושה מדים זה כבר מספר הנורונים שמגיבים הולך כמו ארוך חבר שלישי.
I mean, if you're doing it, there are, like,
Yes, that's true, but you're averaging over the distribution of R given the truth. It's just like within the one dimensional case. You're averaging, you don't know the truth yet, but you do know the distribution of R given it.
Yeah.